Right. Coagulation, flocculation or precipitation of colloids. Previously, I have discussed that the stability of colloids is due to charges on the fixed layer of colloidal particles. In one of the properties of colloids, I have already discussed. There are two layers around the colloidal particles, fixed layer and mobile layer. The colloidal particles, the colloidal solution, whether it is positive or negative, depends on the charges on the fixed layer. Moreover, the colloidal solution is stable because of those charges in the fixed layer. Because of same charges on the in the fixed layer, two colloidal particles do not come into contact because each fixed layer contains the same charges in the colloidal solution. That's why two colloidal particles do not come into contact, because there are same charges now. That's why there is repulsion. When these charges, which are responsible for the stability of a colloid, are removed, then automatically precipitation occurs. So precipitation, flocculation or coagulation, we have different words. Each word gives the same meaning. So what is coagulation? It is the process of settling down. Process of settling down of colloidal particles in the dispersion medium. Dispersion in the dispersion medium. Settling down of colloidal particles in the dispersion medium is called what? Coagulation, flocculation or precipitation of colloids. Okay, now we have two types of colloids based on the interaction between DP and DM. What are those two types of colloids? One is lyophilic, other one is lyophobic. Let's see now the coagulation of, first the coagulation of lyophobic colloids. Coagulation of lyophobic colloids. In that first one, by electrophoresis. Already I have discussed what is electrophoresis. It is the movement of colloidal particles under the influence of an applied EMF towards an electrode. If a positive colloid is electrolyzed, the colloidal particles are deposited at the cathode, because a positive colloid contains cations. That means on fixed layer of colloidal particle, there will be positive charges. That's why all colloidal particles reach the cathode. If a negative colloid is taken, then the colloidal particles reach anode. So whatever be the colloid, during electrophoresis, colloidal particles gets discharged at the respective electrode. So because of this discharge of charges on the colloidal particles causes accumulation because of that coagulation of colloid. Got it? What is electrophoresis? By electrophoresis, colloidal particles all lose their charges at the respective electrode. Respective electrode means at the opposite electrode. If positive colloid, at the cathode, they undergo discharge. For a negative colloid, the colloidal particles undergo discharge at anode. So at the anode or cathode, colloidal particles lose their charges. I said earlier that the charges are responsible for the stability of a colloid. When these colloids lose their charges, automatically they settle down. That is, coagulation occurs. So this is by electrophoresis. Second one, by mixing two oppositely charged colloids. By mixing two oppositely charged colloids. So when you mix one positive colloid and another negative colloid in equimolar ratio, then what happens? Loss of charges, that means neutralization of charges, occurs by mutual coagulation. Mutual coagulation means the charges of positive colloid neutralize the negative charges of negative colloid. Similarly, the negative charge of negative colloid neutralizes the positive charge of positive colloid. So, because of mutual coagulation, here coagulation occurs either partially or completely based on the relative amounts of colloids added. So, if you take hydrated ferric oxide, which is a positive colloid, hydrated ferric oxide is a positive colloid. To this, if another negative colloid, suppose arsenous sulfide colloidal solution is added. Arsenous sulfide colloidal solution is a negative colloid, whereas hydrated ferric oxide colloid is a positive colloid. When these two are mixed, because of mutual neutralization of charges, coagulation occurs. So by mixing two oppositely charged colloids also, coagulation of lyophobic colloids occurs. Third one, prolonged dialysis. Prolonged dialysis. About dialysis, already I have discussed. Dialysis means in a bag made of a membrane, colloidal solution is taken. That colloidal solution is suspended in flowing water. Then what happens? That flowing water takes away the electrolytes along with it, whereas colloidal particles are left behind because that membrane allows only electrolytes and solvent, that means dispersion medium. It does not allow colloidal particles to pass through it. So in that way, when dialysis is carried out for a long time, the electrolytes all are removed from the colloidal solution. I said earlier that a small amount of electrolyte is a must for a colloidal solution for its stability. Why? Because from the electrolyte, colloidal particles absorb charges on its fixed layer. These charges are responsible for the stability of a colloid. When the colloidal solution is subjected to dialysis, what happens? The charges of electrolyte which are on the fixed layer of colloidal particles are removed completely. When these colloidal particles lost their charges, what happens? Automatically the colloidal particles come into contact, their size increases, because of gravity force they simply settle down. So it is prolonged dialysis. Fourth one, by boiling the colloidal solution. What happens in this case? When a colloidal solution is boiled, the charges in the fixed layer gets disturbed by the continuous collisions of dispersion medium. Dispersion medium contains some molecules, na? Those molecules continuously collide the charges on the colloidal particles. Because of this continuous collisions of dispersion medium with the charges on the colloidal particles, what happens? The charges are removed from the surface. When the charges in the fixed layer of colloidal particles are removed, automatically colloidal particles come into contact, their size increases, because of gravity force simply it settles down. Okay, so in that way, by boiling also, lyophobic colloid solutions are coagulated. Fifth one, by the addition of an electrolyte. By the addition of an electrolyte. So a colloidal solution, we know that a colloidal solution contains charges on the fixed layer of colloidal particles. So there are some charges. All the particles in a colloidal solution have same charges. A positive colloid means in that all the colloidal particles contain positive charges in the fixed layer. A negative colloid means in that all the colloidal particles contain negative charges in the fixed layer. So when an electrolyte, I said earlier that electrolyte is certain minimum requisite amount, it is responsible for the stability of a colloid, because this electrolyte gives charges in the fixed layer of colloidal particles. Whereas that electrolyte is added in excess amounts, what happens? Automatically, neutralization of charges occurs by the opposite ions of the electrolyte. In that way, it gets coagulated. So, by the addition of electrolyte, a lyophobic colloidal solution easily coagulated. See here, the ion of electrolyte which is responsible for the neutralization of charges is called coagulating ion. What is coagulating ion? Coagulating ion is the ion of electrolyte, is the ion of electrolyte which is responsible for the neutralization of charges on the colloidal particles is called coagulating ion. The ion of electrolyte which is responsible for the neutralization of charges on the colloidal particles is called what? Coagulating ion. You know, coagulating ion may be positive ion or negative ion. For a positive colloid, which is coagulating ion? For a positive colloid, negative ion of the electrolyte is the coagulating ion. Whereas for negative colloid, positive ion of the electrolyte positive ion of the electrolyte is responsible for coagulation. So a positive colloid is coagulated by negative ion of the electrolyte, whereas a negative colloid is coagulated by positive ion of the electrolyte. Here there is a law which explains the power of a coagulating ion. That law is Hardy-Schulze principle. Let's see what is Hardy-Schulze principle. Hardy-Schulze principle is, greater the valency of coagulating ion, greater is its tendency to coagulate. That means if any ion, coagulating ion, is having more charge, that's coagulating power is more. If any coagulating ion is having more charge, its coagulating power is more. That is Hardy-Schulze principle. Let's see the statement for Hardy-Schulze principle. Hardy-Schulze principle. What is this? Hardy-Schulze principle is, greater the valency, that means charge, of the coagulating ion, greater the valency of coagulating ion, more is the coagulating power of, more is the coagulating power of that ion. So if any coagulating, greater the valency of the coagulating ion, more is the coagulating power of that ion. If any ion is having more charge, its power to coagulate the colloid is more. For example, take a positive colloid. So, which can cause coagulation of this positive colloid? Yes, negative ion of the electrolytes. So, for this positive colloid, we can add NaCl. From that, Cl minus causes coagulation. We can add some Na2SO4. From that, sulfate ion causes the coagulation. We can add aluminium phosphate. From that, sodium phosphate. From that, phosphate ion causes coagulation. So, in that way, let's see some ions of electrolyte which can cause a positive colloidal solution to coagulate. So, examples are, Cl minus less than, SO4 2 minus less than, PO4 3 minus less than, FeCN6 4 minus. See here once, this is the positive colloid. Here we have added sodium chloride, sodium sulfate, sodium phosphate, sodium ferrocyanide separately. Then which can cause easy coagulation? This one, yes. Why? This ion can cause coagulation very easily. Because this ion has more charge, more negative charge. Minus 4 charge it has. That means it can remove one ion of this electrolyte can remove 4 positive charges from the colloidal particle. If you take NaCl, their Cl minus, one Cl minus can neutralize only one positive charge on the colloid. So, which one is required in minimum amounts? This one. So, in minimum amounts also it can cause coagulation completely. But for this positive colloid, by the addition of NaCl to cause coagulation, more amount of NaCl is required. So, if any electrolyte is required in smaller amounts to cause coagulation, that is powerful electrolyte for the coagulation. So, among the 4, which is powerful electrolyte for the coagulation? Ferrocyanide. Ferrocyanide ion is the powerful coagulating ion. Because even in smaller amounts also, it causes the coagulation of a positive colloid. Similarly, for a negative colloid, let us take Na plus, NaCl, MgCl2, AlCl3. Okay, in those salts, from NaCl, Na plus causes the coagulation, because here we are discussing about negative colloid. A negative colloid is coagulated by positive ion of the salt or electrolyte. So NaCl, from NaCl, Na plus is the coagulating ion. From MgCl to Mg plus 2 is the coagulating ion. From AlCl3, Al plus 3 is the coagulating ion. So, their coagulating power is like that. So, even a small amount of AlCl3 can cause coagulation of this negative colloidal solution easily. But by sodium chloride to cause coagulation of this negative colloid, very larger amount is required than AlCl3. So, amount of NaCl required is more than that of AlCl3 for the coagulation of this negative colloid. That means among the 3, which is a powerful coagulating ion? Yes, AlCl3. That means Al3 plus is the powerful coagulating ion. So in that way, a positive colloid is coagulated by negative ions of the salt. Similarly, a negative colloid is coagulated by positive ions of the salt. Okay, next, let's see a definition. The power of this salt is indicated by a definition called coagulating value or flocculating value. So for that, let's see the definition. Flocculation value. Flocculation value or coagulating value. Coagulating value. What is this? Very, very important definition for IPE. This is define flocculation value or simply define coagulation value. Coagulating value or coagulation value. What is the definition? So, why do we use this term? We use this flocculation value to explain the coagulating power of an electrolyte. So, it represents the coagulating power of an ion or electrolyte, an electrolyte, that means ion, coagulating power of an electrolyte. What is the definition for flocculation value? It is the minimum concentration of electrolyte. In millimoles per liter. The minimum concentration of an electrolyte in millimoles per liter that causes coagulation of a colloid. Coagulation of a colloid in 2 hours duration. So see the definition for this flocculation value. It is the minimum concentration of an electrolyte in millimoles per liter that causes coagulation of a colloid in 2 liters. Sorry, in 2 hours. In 2 hours duration, the number of millimoles of electrolyte that causes coagulation of a colloid is said to be flocculation value. Some problems may be asked in object 2 based on the flocculation value. How? See, a colloidal solution is 2 liters. To cause coagulation of this 2 liters colloidal solution, suppose some 10 moles of some X salt is added. To cause 2 liters of a colloidal solution to coagulate, 10 moles of some X is added. X means electrolyte is added. Then what is flocculation value? Listen the question once again. What is the flocculation value when 10 moles of electrolyte X is added to 2 liters of a colloidal solution? So here colloidal solution 2 liters, salt added 10 moles. What is the flocculation value? So how to use the definition to solve it? What is the definition says? It is the concentration of electrolyte, minimum concentration of electrolyte in millimoles per liter. So for that, to satisfy the definition, here the solution volume, colloidal solution volume must be 1 liter. But in the given question, it is given as 2 liters. For 2 liters, 10 moles required, salt. Then for 1 liter, how many moles will be required? Yes, 5 moles. For 2 liters of colloidal solution, 10 moles of salt is required for the coagulation. Then for 1 liter, how many moles are required? 5 moles is required. Okay, so here 5 moles of salt is required for the coagulation of 1 liter colloid. But here flocculation value must be in millimoles. 5 moles means how many millimoles? Yes, 5 moles means 5 into 10 power 10 cube into 10 power minus 3 moles. We can write 5 moles as 5 into 10 cube into 10 power minus 3 moles. But you know, this 5 into 10 cube means 5000. 10 power minus 3 moles means millimoles. So what is the answer for the given question? 5000. So flocculation value of the given electrolyte X is what is that? 5000. Why 5000? Because in 2 liters, for the coagulation of 2 liters of colloid, 10 moles of salt is required. Na? Then for the coagulation of 1 liter, how many moles will be required? 5 moles. 5 moles means 5000 millimoles. 5000 millimoles. So 5000 millimoles of the salt is required for the coagulation of 1 liter of the colloidal solution. So what is the minimum concentration of electrolyte required for the coagulation of 1 liter here? 5000 millimoles. So answer for that flocculation value is 5000. So in that way we can solve the problem related to flocculation value. Okay, so this is about flocculation value, very very important definition for IPE, and in Eamcet and mains also there will be a question on flocculation value. So these are all the 5 factors that can coagulate a negative colloid. What are the 5 factors I have discussed earlier? First one by electrophoresis. Second one by mixing to oppositely charged colloids. Third one by boiling. Fourth one by prolonged dialysis. Fifth one by the addition of electrolytes. Got it? So this is about coagulation of lyophobic colloids.